Hey, good morning, church family. How are we doing this morning? Good, good. Great to see your faces this morning. Thank you guys for joining us here at Trinity. We're definitely glad to see you guys here. Before I get in trouble, one big announcement I want to make sure that to get out while I can remember it, and Derek's going to help me with it, is our adult ministry for the SALT group, the home group that meets at Buddy and Linda's house, is going to be this Friday. And the SALT stands for Seeking a Life Transformed. So a great opportunity to get to know each other in a smaller setting and just have a meal together and just enjoy some fellowship time. So if you have questions about that, feel free to see Mr. Buddy in the back or Miss Jade. There we go. All right. Huh? Who's also in the back. So we have a theme, Back Row Baptist. We love it. So glad that you guys are here joining us on this happy Mother's Day morning. So thank you for being here. If you guys will stand and join with us, we'll kick off our worship this morning.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait.
Just a minute and say good morning. You get bonus points if you find a McGee that you've never met before. There's lots of them today. Young men that are helping with our offering, if you guys will come forward. Derek, will you come help us out this morning? Azariah, you had that look. There's one extra plate with your name on it, brother.
Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning. Just want to say thank you for all the mothers that are here in attendance. We also want to say thank you just for allowing everyone to be here and come get here safely. Bless these offerings to the church. Be with Pastor Robbie as he delivers a message this morning. In your name we pray.
Amen.
Praise forever to the King of Kings.
so thankful that you're worthy of our praise. You're worthy of our worship this morning. God, just help us to focus on you. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. There is a truth older than the ages. There is a promise of things yet to come. There is one born for our salvation, Jesus. There is a light that overwhelms the darkness. There is a kingdom that forever reigns. There is freedom from the chains that bind us. Jesus, Jesus.
Come to the
Father, we're thankful for today. We're thankful for an opportunity as a church family to come together to the altar, to pray together, to love on one another, to build each other up. But most importantly, God, that we have you to cling to. God, we ask that as we continue through our service, that you would just guide our hearts and our minds to focus on you, to set aside anything that's distracting us, anything that's trying to call us away or to draw us away, God, that we could spend some time with you this morning. God, we're thankful for this church family, and we're thankful for Pastor Robbie, and we just ask that you would just strengthen him as he boldly proclaims your word this morning. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. You guys may be seated.
Amen. Good morning, church. Happy Mother's Day. If you are a mother figure, a mother, a grandmother, an aunt, a sister that helped raise a sibling or something like that, if you would stand this morning, if you have had influence in the life of a youngster or the life of an adolescent, you've helped raise, mentor, disciple, let's give the Lord a hand clap. Ladies, thank you for everything that you do. As you well know, the men in the room would be totally lost if it wasn't for you. I got an amen out of that. Yes, it's a true point. In our car, we might be lost geographically if it wasn't for me. But if it wasn't for my bride, Sarah, I would certainly be lost. It would be a bad situation. So, honey, thank you for everything you do. I love you. And my mom is here this morning, Kenya, my mother-in-law, Judy. And those of you in the room who have been influenced heavily and heavenly by a mother, a grandmother, a mother-in-law, you know how special that bond is. And some of you in the room this morning have lost that person that was so near and dear to you. And for that reason, this might be a tough Mother's Day. And I hate that. That pain, that grief, that loss. But there is hope. There's hope that you will see her again one day. There is hope that you will get to laugh and hopefully tell stories again one day. And there's also hope in Jesus Christ. You get to share the stories and the legacy that lives on in that person's life that you miss so dearly. So today I hope that you can take hope and take courage in knowing that the Lord has us. Amen? Amen. Exodus chapter 20, verse 7 is where we will be today. The title of today's message is Taming the Tongue and the Heart. This is a series. If you're visiting today, welcome. This is a series on the Ten Commandments. And today we work on the Lord's name in vain. I don't know that I've ever preached a standalone passage on this commandment, but I'm excited to do so. It's been a really rich time of reflection throughout the week. And last night as I was working through some thoughts and studying a bit, and this morning, I was reminded of how impactful the power of a name is. Let's read a little bit from the Word of the Lord this morning in Exodus chapter 20, verse 7. If you found it, give me an amen. Amen. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain, for the Lord will not hold him guiltless who takes his name in vain. Whenever I was a kiddo, I remember someone explaining to me what the Lord's name in vain meant. And the way that it was taught to me in children's church was, it's like taking the most valuable thing that you have in your life and lying about it and saying it's worthless. The most valuable thing in your life, and you lie about it and say that it's worthless. It's a pretty good explanation from Miss Sandy, our children's church teacher, speaking of people that had a lot of influence in life. Because if you think about it, the things that you want to hold on to, the things that you place value in, you place merit in, you place worship and adoration toward, whenever you think about it, those are the very things that we ought to exalt and we ought to tell others about. But instead, there are times when someone says they love something, but everything in their actions doesn't show that. If you've ever been in a relationship that was toxic, or there was addiction, or there was a problem, or there was violence, or there was anger, or there was great temptation, and there was brokenness in the relationship, you know what it feels like, no matter which side of that coin you were on at different parts of your life, in different seasons, you know that there are times when you do love someone dearly and you do things that you deeply regret. And you don't understand why you did it, but it happened, and then you've got to explain yourself, and then you've got to discuss it, and then you've got to come back together somehow in the brokenness and in the pain, and you say, why did I do that? For what reason did I do that? And we see throughout Scripture, folks, we see that children of God, favored people, called people, people that were the apple in the eye of the Lord, people that had a calling and a giftedness, they fall down face first and face plant. They are broken. They're sinful. We're sinful. And then there are times whenever the words we say and the names that we speak and the heart that is behind what is said, we don't know why we chose that. We don't know why we do that. We don't know why we allowed that to happen. Thus, sometimes we do use the Lord's name in vain. There are three things. Phrases, Hebrew words in our text that drive this passage as you read it. We already talked about the words, you shall not. But then you see, that was 2 weeks ago, but then you see this phrase, take the name. Take the name. What does it mean to name something? Well, the Hebrew phrase here actually means, whenever it uses the word name, it's talking about something that we hold. Something that we take hold of. If you ever want to see the power of a name, look at a 2 or a 3-year-old who misses grandma and grandpa, or Mimi and Pop, or Grandma and Papa, or Granny. Just find the child that really loves and adores grandma and grandpa, and when they're not looking, say, I wonder if grandma's coming today. And they'll awake from their slumber, and they'll pop up and say, grandma, grandma, grandma. They're going to look around. Where's grandma? Where's grandma? Oh, I'm just playing with you. The tears are going to come. I mean, heck with mom and dad. Y'all know how that goes, right? Mom and dad are just like, we're on the bench somewhere. We're fourth or fifth in the depth chart compared to all the grandparents and all the favorite people. But the name, how else would that child know you by name? You've got to have a name. You've got to have some kind of a definition in the child's mind and in their heart. And the fact that they get so excited about your name before they've even seen you means that they know who you are. They know something about you. They feel comforted. They feel warmth. They feel devotion. They feel love. And the name Jesus, the name Yahweh, in the Old Testament, you know the name Yahweh, we see 7,000 times in the Old Testament. And over the centuries, we see that some of the earliest Christians, they read certain passages and they were taught certain tradition to the point that they respected the name Yahweh so much that they were actually scared to say it in a sentence or in conversation for fear that they might mess up the way that they say it. You know, the passage, don't blaspheme the Holy Spirit, or the passage here or a little bit later in the Old Testament in Leviticus where it describes how to speak about the Lord and how not to, we'll see in just a few minutes, how not to go into an oath or a covenant with someone in the Lord's name that you know you're going to break. So because of that, people were really scared to say the Lord's name because they didn't want to screw it up. That's how much they revered the name of the Lord. But listen to the kids today. Listen to yourself today. Listen to parents today. They say, oh God, all the time. Or, oh my gosh. And they don't even realize that they say it. And you want to say, oh God, what? Oh God bless you. Oh God loves you. Oh God loves me. I've heard some phrases before that were referenced towards umpires and referees that didn't say, oh God bless you. Right? You've seen that. You've been there. We've got some umpires in the room. It doesn't take much to set people off nowadays, or especially on social media. So the power of the name Yahweh, if you look throughout Scripture, is proclaimed every time there's a good and perfect blessing. Every time there's a defeat, you see the children of Israel cry out the name Yahweh. Every time there's a victory, victory is mine, says the Lord. You see the children of Israel cry out and claim victory, and then what do? They worship Yahweh. But then you see the times when people completely ignore what God is doing. But yet they say that they believe. Psalm 145, verse 3 says, your name is great and greatly to be praised. Your name is great and greatly to be praised. The psalmist is saying, oh God, I can't say your name enough. Every time I sing, I want to say your name. Every time I think about you, I want to say your name. Every time I look at your creation, I want to say your name. Every time I'm with my family and I look at the blessings, I want to say your name. Every time I share a meal, I want to say your name. Every time I lay my hand to the plow, I want to say your name. Your name is great and greatly to be praised. Your name means something, God. So what is God telling Moses? He's saying, hey, pass this along to the people. Tell the people, do not use my name in vain. Whenever you use my name, make sure it's in the right purpose, the right heart. Moms in the room, there's a name for you on Mother's Day that our kids call you. I always called my mom Mama. And she always called her mom Mama. It's kind of interesting in our home. Now I think it's Mom. Yeah, and if she was chastising me or I was in trouble, which was fairly rare as I got older, I would normally come back with Mother. She'd say, mm-mm. And y'all know how, don't act like you had never been in trouble with your mom before. Come on. I know how that goes. Okay? Now, As you get older, though, there's all kinds of phrases. Mom. The first time Ben called Sarah mom, we both looked at each other. It wasn't mommy. It was like, wait a minute, big for your britches. What was that? Did you just say mom? It's not mommy anymore. But to some moms nowadays, I've heard students in my classes say, bruh, bro. I'm looking around for a belt or a paddle. Did you just call your mom bruh? Yes. Yeah. Hey, the name for your mom should have merit and weight and respect and love and adoration. And kiddos, and I'm speaking to myself, the way that mom and dad love each other is the way that we ought to see Christ loves us. The parents in the room, to be real. Husbands, the way you speak to your wife, it ought to be the way that Christ loves the church and loves us. And husbands in the room, when we fall short, when we give up, when we quit, when we speak ill to our bride, whenever we speak down to our bride, whenever we don't show love and compassion like Christ loved the church, how did He love the church? He died for us. Whenever we don't have the servant's heart to wash our bride's feet, to make sure that things are taken care of, to make sure that they're spoken to in love, whenever we don't do that, we don't model how Christ loved us to our kids. This Mother's Day, men, I want to challenge you to step up our game. Speak lovingly to our bride. Speak lovingly. Maybe you are in a difficult place in life and you find yourself separated, single, divorced, whatever it might be. And it's ridiculously hard sometimes to speak kindly of your former spouse. But we have an obligation in our children's eyes to show them how Christ has loved us. Amen, church? Your name means something, and the way that we speak of names means something. And the way that we use God's name, Yahweh, it ought to mean something. When it comes out of our mouth, it ought to be to worship Him. Then you see this phrase in the second part of verse 7, you shall take the name of the Lord your God. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. In vain. To think of the word vain, it means false or empty. It's like something has nothing. It's worthless. It's a token of a vessel. It's similar in word, a picture of a word that would mean you walk into a store with something you think is very valuable. And you know that it's very valuable by the serial number and the manufacturer, and you know what it's worth. And the owner of the store looks at you and says, I appreciate you coming in today, but this isn't worth anything to me. And you look at the store owner and you look at the item and say, well, this is a 1969 Nolan Ryan card with the Mets when they won the World Series. And he says, well, I hate the Mets. You hate the Mets? What are you talking about? That was back when they were actually decent. What do you mean you hate? Before long, you realize he's not understanding what I'm saying. I'm holding something of value, but he's degrading the value of what I know has value. That's exactly what God is talking about. I created you. I sustain you. I've provided for you. You are my chosen people. And after I've shown you all of that love, all of that compassion, all of that sustenance for life, I've even given you a pathway from sin through the sacrificial lamb. And after all of that, instead of valuing the love I've given to you and valuing the life that I've blessed you with and valuing the deliverance that I'm providing for your people right now after you've sinned, instead of understanding and accepting that love, what have you done, children? You have ignored me. You've defaced and defamed my name. Whenever we speak in such a way or live in such a way that those around us don't see God's name as famous, they don't see God's name as merciful, they don't see God's name as loving and kind and creator and authoritative and omnipotent, they don't see Him in your life in that way, guess what? It's the same thing as using a curse word with the Lord's name in vain. Because, yes, words matter and names matter, but what matters even more than words and names? Your actions. Who you are. We should lift the name of the Lord Most High with our life. So God is speaking to Moses to warn against those who raise the name of God in a way that is worthless or degrading. You see this throughout Scripture. Leviticus 19:12, I referenced just a bit ago, says, "You shall not swear by my name falsely and so profane the name of your God. I am the Lord." So if you raise your right hand, or if you speak to someone and say, you know how you'll hear someone say, "I swear on my grandmother's grave." How dare you? Unless you're really going to do it. Because it ain't her fault you can't keep your word. Right? Take that a whole nother notch. Swear to God above that you're going to tell the truth to the person that's asking you a question and then go lie. Go break your oath. Go break your handshake. That's using the name of the Lord your God in vain. Hosea 10:4 says, "They have spoken words, swearing falsely and making a covenant. Thus judgment springeth up." I grabbed the King James Version. I love it. "Springeth up as a hemlock in the furrows of the field." Whenever you swear falsely, whenever you take a false covenant that you can't hold up, and you already know it's not true, you know you're going to break it in the Lord's name. Hosea says judgment's going to spring. If it's going to sprout, it's going to rise. Don't be surprised. Don't be shocked. The Lord's name in vain is often assumed to be akin to using a curse word that starts with the word God. And you know what I'm talking about. I won't say it in this pulpit. And it's the simplest form of using the Lord's name in vain. Yes, but think about all of the Christian symbols that are on the back of vehicles as you drive down the interstate. There's nothing more fun than seeing the Christian fish and noticing it as someone cuts me off and almost hits me. It's such a great testimony. Do you agree? It's like, "Oh, God bless you too. Thank you so much." And there's nothing worse than seeing the fish symbol as they cut me off and I slam on my brakes and then they wave at me. And "God bless you too. It's great. Thank you." Right? There's nothing worse than a business card someone hands you for their company to advertise. And they say, there's a cross, or "We love Jesus," or something like that, or a scripture. They hand you a card, and then they come out and do the work for you, and you think to yourself, "Oh, boy, this is great. It's a Christian guy." And you find out 2 years later he did the job completely wrong. Your roof's leaking, your paint's falling off, the caulk didn't stick, the tile's cracking. They didn't tell you what they're doing with your investment account. You just completely trusted them. Whatever it is that they do in their business, you find out they didn't do it right. And you want to go back to the person and say, "Why did you do that? Why didn't you bid this straight up? Why didn't you share what was going to happen? Why didn't you let me know that there were deeper problems before you bid this job? We probably could have worked something out." But instead, they're flying the Christian flag as salesmanship, not as a Christian. Think about all the celebrities. Think about all the celebrities. Whenever they really fall and screw up, they proclaim the name of the Lord that they're going to be forgiven. But all the people that they hurt, all the words that they say, does it exemplify Christ? Does it lift the name of the Lord Yahweh high? Is the banner being held for the whole world to see? Or are they an undercover Christian? What's the big deal? There's grace for all, right? I mean, what's the big deal? Well, the problem is, yes, you will be forgiven. If you've truly accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, yes. You place your faith in Him, you receive Him as Lord and Savior, you ask Him to forgive you of your sin, you start walking in Him, but therein lies the problem. If you've cheated half the town, if you speak ill, if you don't live like a Christian, here's the problem. No one around you knows that you are a believer. Now only you and the Lord know. But at that point, I have to ask you, what's the point of it all? What's the purpose of it all? What's the purpose of living this life and saying you're a Christian if in reality nothing you do says, I am a Christian, including the names that you use? What's the big deal? Here's the big deal. Moses didn't even know what to call God. If you go back to Exodus 3, you don't have to turn there for time's sake, but if you go back to Exodus 3, if you're new to the Word of God today, and you're a seeker in the room, you want to know more about God and His path in our lives and the Word of God and Scripture, there's this amazing story in Exodus chapter 3. You need to read it. If you're a young person in the room and you don't know the story, grab a Bible with mom and dad, grandma and grandpa, read it. If you can't find Exodus, it's the second book, but look in the table of contents in the very front. Don't be embarrassed. And in Exodus 3, you see Moses is standing there and God allows this bush to catch on fire randomly. And Moses is standing there staring into the fire. Moses is this really awesome, amazing man that screwed up. But at this point, he was the guy that was going to lead the children from lostness and be found in the promised land. And God gives him these directions, these instructions. And he says, go tell the people. And Moses says, when they ask, who do I tell them you are? Tell them I am. I am. That's what you tell them. In Hebrew, if you like were to draw this English equivalency to a debate today, and someone said, I am, that's just like saying, that speaker right there, it is. And Ronnie J right here, he is. He's right here. God says, I am. I'm right here. I am. I always have been. I always will be. I am. Can you imagine Moses watching this bush burn? And a voice is coming out of it. And now he has to go tell these people, here's the word from the Lord. And they're going to say, who told you this? I am sent me. What? I am sent me. Who's I am? Exactly. I am. God. The main man. And then fast forward, Exodus 34, once again, we don't have time, but just to foreshadow a bit. Exodus 34, Moses has gotten angry. He's gotten upset. More than likely, he has completely burned out because he is completely worn down from criticism and issues among the people. Like, that never happens anymore. And then he breaks the tablets that he wrote the Ten Commandments on, and now God is upset with him. Understandably so. You just destroyed the only copy that we got, homeboy, bro. And then what? He says, I'm going to give you these again. Make two copies. And then come on up to the mount. Folks, here's what's so amazing about the name of God. As you think about your speech and think about the way that you lift the name of God high, think about what Moses looked like when he came down from the mount. He finishes up his business with God. He comes down from the mount in chapter 34 of the book of Exodus and so on. He comes down from the mount and the people were scared to look at Moses. Have you ever seen one of those little puppy dogs that's kind of shy with the real big eyes? They're all over TikTok and Instagram and Facebook on the shorts, they call them. The people that are older in the room, anybody over 30, shorts are really short videos that just play on replay. Okay? And the students stare at them like zombies all day long. Okay? That's how they learn today. I think we ought to teach the gospel in shorts. I'm not kidding. Anyways, he comes down. Well, it's like having the puppy dog with the big eyes, and every time you look at it, he looks away. And you look at it, and he looks away. That's what the people did whenever Moses comes down off the mountain. You know why? They looked at each other, and they said, his face is shining. His face is shining. They didn't even want to look at it because they were scared to look at the Lord. And Moses was radiant in his face. He had seen the Lord and it was like it was contagious. The name of the Lord isn't just a name on paper. Yahweh, God Almighty, is a living God. He's alive. He's active in our world. He doesn't just set the world in motion and it spins and it does its thing. He maintains the world. You know, the sun has all the intricacies and all the chemistry and the physics going on. Guess who set that in motion and keeps it going today? Guess who got you out of bed this morning and allowed your heart to beat again? Yahweh. So whenever I lift high the name of the Lord, this is the same God that Moses went up the mount to meet with. This is the same God that made His face shine. So Moses put on a veil. He put on a veil so that they'd feel comfortable talking to him. And then he would talk to God. He would lift the veil. When he talked to the people, he would lower the veil. That's the power of God in our lives, a personal relationship. It's the same God that raised Jesus from the dead after He sent Him here to die for us. Not for sin of His own, but for ours. That's the name that we lift high. That's the name that we need to honor and treasure. So every person in the room, we have a challenge in this scripture. We've heard it. We know a little bit more about the background of the name of God now. We know about the power of God. Even if you're new to church in the room and new to scripture in the room, now you've heard just a tidbit of the gospel message. But now what? Well, to apply it, now we get to go live it. My guess is by, I don't know, lunch 30 today, there'll be a certain number of people in the room that have already screwed this up. Yeah. One day leaving a church parking lot, a kid flew by on a four-wheeler. I nearly T-boned this kid on a four-wheeler. And I taught this student. I know him. Deep breath, Pastor. Pulling out of the parking lot right here. Hey. The world is going to be the world. And you're always going to be a peculiar Jesus freak. Lift His name high. And whenever we fall, guess what? Let's get back up. Ask for forgiveness. Speak kindly and keep moving forward. Amen? Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank You for Your Word. I thank You for the challenge that we see. The challenge is how to keep our heart in You. And Lord, we all fail at that. But it's strengthened through being here. It's strengthened through Sunday school. It's strengthened through small groups. It's strengthened through Wednesday night Bible study. It's strengthened through prayer. Strengthened through meditating on Your Word, focusing on You, worshiping You. And Lord, as we continuously do that day after day, as we are sanctified, as we grow in our faith in Jesus, Lord, I pray that those around us would see such a change. They would see such a maturity that they don't understand where it comes from, but that they would know we lift high Yahweh. So, Lord, the challenge is great, but we get to trust and lean on You. We're not in this alone. And I thank You that today on this Mother's Day, no one here is alone. Whether we've lost a loved one, whether we struggle with a relationship with a child who's not near us, whatever the instance may be this Mother's Day that is troublesome, Lord, I know that the Holy Spirit is the great comforter. And I pray that today, in the name of Jesus, we would feel the warmth that only You can give. Lord, I pray today if someone in this room has heard the gospel message and they've yet to believe and trust in You, I pray that today could be that day, that they'd respond to the gospel call, place their faith in You. Lord, I thank You that You can forgive them of their sin in less than a moment's notice because of Jesus. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. And everybody said, amen. Amen. If you would, please stand as we sing, Jesus Paid It All. Great time of worship. Ronnie, what all plants do we have up here? Ladies in the room, we got a gift for you. Ronnie, what all are the plants? Jalapenos? Hot and mild peppers, tomatoes. Okay. Now the one that we're going to take Connie to lay hands on and speak life into this plant, because sometimes plants, it must be the soil. I don't know what's going on at the house, but tomatoes just don't make it. And if they do make it, Ben eats it before it's even ripe. Yeah. Sarah says she needs the one on the stage. It's not real. All right. Okay. Well, ladies, I'm going to close in prayer, but feel free to come forward and grab. I'm going to let you pick. If I have the kiddos hand them out, you might get something that, like a hot pepper or something that you're not a big fan of. So once I close in prayer, you are more than welcome to come up and grab one of those. And I think that's a really great idea because it's something that we get to nurture and watch throughout the year. It's pretty special. Amen? Amen. Do we have any announcements? I know Angela mentioned the possibility of a mosaic meeting following worship service next Sunday. Anything to add? Okay. Awesome. All right. Thank you for that. If you want to be involved in Mosaic, we need you. All hands on deck. That's our art camp. That's a week long this summer. We would love to have you serve and join. Any other announcements this morning? Salt group Friday night, Miss Judy says, at Buddy and Linda's. If you don't know where that is, reach out. We'll get you there. And then City on a Hill missions opportunity is next Sunday. What time? 2 to 4 p.m. So if you'd like to serve in a missions opportunity and you haven't done that, come talk to us. We'll connect you with the right people and make sure that you can get plugged in and serve. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for today. I thank you for the opportunity to worship Jesus Christ, the risen Savior. I thank you for the moms in the room. I thank you, Lord, that you have provided them for us, that you've graced us with them. Lord, I pray that their legacy would live on. I pray, Lord, as we go throughout the rest of this day, that you would bless us and keep us. May your face shine upon us. It's in the name of Christ we pray. And everybody said, amen. You guys have a great week.